Tired of searching for podcasts? Try Storio, the only app you need to discover and follow podcasts from across the world. Get curated podcasts and playlists every day and listen to what your friends recommend. Share what you love and find what they love. Check us out on storiowedge.com/boom. Download on App Store or Play Store. Storio.
Welcome to Audiogyan with Kedar Nimkar, a podcast that documents insightful conversations with Indian designers, artists, musicians, writers, thinkers, and creatives of all types. Catch us on iTunes or visit audiogyan.com for more Gyan sessions. Here's your host, Kedar Nimkar.
Welcome to a brand new episode of Audiogyan Case Studies. Today I have Viraj Verma with us. Viraj is an architect turned self-taught user experience designer who graduated from IIT Roorkee. He is currently leading the design team at Blackbuck, an online marketplace seamlessly connecting shippers and carriers across India and working with truck owners and drivers of this highly unorganized sector. And today we are here to discuss what goes on designing an experience for these technologically challenged users. So thank you, Viraj, for giving us your time, and it's a real pleasure to have you on Audiogyan.
Thank you, Kedar. Thank you so much. I'm really, it really feels awesome to be here and share my experience with Audiogyan.
Sure. Thanks a lot. And I mean, the whole premise of our conversation will be, so I would like to tell our listeners that we met in Design Up conference, and he shared a lot of insights, what he's building right now, what are the challenges. And I really wanted to just document what his process is, because he's actually going down to the grassroots level of India, tier 2, tier 3 cities, and designing something really awesome there. The first question which I wanted to ask you is, what does Blackbuck do essentially? I mean, what is the company about? And
yeah, right. So Kedar, basically Blackbuck is the Uber for trucks for India. The trucking industry in India is huge, like $100 billion sector itself. So on a very high level, when merchants, they need to transport their goods from A to B. So that's when they hire these fleet owners, which are basically, someone who is owning a single truck or double truck or 5 trucks or 10 trucks, something like that. And they also have loyal drivers. So these are the people you see on your road trips. So basically, there's one fact which I want to tell you, that, 85% of the movements on the national highways in India are completely commercial. So think about it, when you are like going on a road and, you are watching the truck drivers, the roads are actually meant for them. So this is one of the things. So basically, this entire process is a very, unstructured, unorganized process. And it's a very traditional industry, which has been existing in India since last 50 years now. So one of the thing is that, this entire network acts as a circulatory system for India. And, it is very important that we bring in some efficiency into this, long lost technologically challenged sector, where nothing has been done, nothing really technological or, any digital interactions have been given to them. Mm-hmm. So this is where, Blackbuck comes into the picture. So we are trying to infuse this sector with technological products so that the entire process can become efficient. Mm-hmm. And all the stakeholders can interact with each other magically. So that is where that is what our company is doing, basically. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And also, just to set context, when you said 85% of this sector moving on the roads is all logistics, so you remember we were speaking about, like, if you can share some sort of insights as to this Amazon, Swiggy, Uber, and people who are actually on the road,
right?
How much percent of traffic do they consume, as opposed to the movers and packers kind of things, and then the bigger sector where people transport, right, groceries and things like that? So, like, how is this market in terms of percentage, if you can share some numbers?
Sure. So I want to make a differentiation over here in the category that we are actually in. Hmm. So you might, when I say that merchants, transferring their loads from A to B, I am actually talking about, huge traders who are actually, moving raw materials or moving finished goods for larger, longer distances between the states. Hmm. So I'm talking about them. Now they and there are other players as well. There are Swiggy's, there are Porter, there are, you know, other players who are doing intrastate or intercity kind of a movement. But our movement is actually, you know, from state to state. So which actually contributes to 85% of the entire logistics sector. So if you are kind of, you know, making a pie chart, this entire region is actually, you know, the long haul logistics, the sector in which we are in, and the rest of the you know, a pie has been is been taken by the others, other players, and, you know, other stuff like movement of goods, basically.
And what kind of goods are these, just to know?
So it can be anything, you know. They are all raw materials which are going from, let's say, from India to South Africa. So they are being transported from UP to Gujarat first, and then being shipped to, you know, Saudi Arabia or South Africa. It can be coal, which is kind of, you know, coming from South Africa and which is going to the factories of India, which is a little cheap coal. So this comprises everything except the perishable goods. So there's a separate category which is perishable goods, but yeah, everything else is kind of, you know, your goods movement, which
so
is happening.
Wood, steel, coal, and all
wood,
this.
Steel, coal, iron rods, everything, like beverages. So yeah, so wow. So there's like 130 list of 137 items that we have right now on the platform. So which we are doing.
So yeah, I mean, if you want to slightly highlight more on the kind of challenges which you have, or let's take a step back and we'll start off with like the design part of it. So how big is the design team? I mean, like, just from a number standpoint.
Right. So basically, Blackbuck has been in existence since last year, 3 years. I joined them, 1.5 years back. And at that time, there were no designers. So I was the first designer. And, you know, so after that, we have grown to a team of 5 members now, full-time members in Bangalore office. Yes. And we are hiring further. So, yeah.
Yeah, that will be a plug at the end of this episode. So yeah, can you tell us what are the main challenges while designing interfaces for this? I mean, this you can go as much deep as you want, because a lot of things we shared offline, but if you can just slightly articulate them to tell us what kind of challenges are, because from my understanding, at least, you are designing for 2 to 3 different types of stakeholders in this entire ecosystem.
Right.
So can you touch upon them and tell us?
So yeah, so challenges, so as you know, so since we are kind of defining interfaces for a large portion of our stakeholders, so every screen presents a new challenge. Every screen has a, you know, has is solving some problem, which is again a problem. So in a world where majority of your audience is either first time smartphone user or first time app user or both, imagine how difficult it would be even to, you know, make an illiterate truck driver conquer the idea of digital touch screen or delete dustbin icon. So the entire problem was full of challenges. But you know, so when I joined, I actually went for a trip. I went to 5 states. I traveled around 9,000 kilometers, you know, by road, by air, and, you know, I was just meeting all these truck drivers and the truck owners. And that actually gave a lot of insights, fundamental insights as to what their business actually is and how can we translate that research into our design ideas. So basically, there were challenges, but we were ensuring that, you know, we are following a certain design process while we are creating the interfaces for them, who are essentially, you know, very new to the concept of any digital product. So some of the things that we did were, like, for example, you know, how do you explain error message to, you know, this kind of an audience? So what does the, you know, term that we commonly use, and, you know, that oops, there's an error, or sorry,
something went wrong.
So how do you kind of, you know, design all those interactions from ground up for this kind of an audience? So what we thought was that, you know,
To interrupt you. These kind of audiences, in there's first of all the truck drivers, then there is any more other people who are interacting with the system?
So yeah, so there are like multiple stakeholders which are there in this entire, you know, trucking industry. First of all, there are, of course, the you know, shippers who actually want to hire those fleet of trucks. Then there are the owners of those fleet of trucks who are, again, you know, so you might have seen those transport nuggers which are, you know, in a very tier 2 kind of a setup or outside your cities. So what happens is all these truck owners are actually scattered around the, you know, towns and tier two cities of India. And so they are again the stakeholder. They are the ones who are using one of the apps for us and making the entire process efficient. But then again, there are truck drivers. So there are like these three, four main, you know, stakeholders which are there and who are using the suite of apps that, you know, we are running for them. So, so this is the audience which is there for you. Someone, you know, might not even know, you know, English. Someone might not even know Hindi beyond a certain level. You know, so they are very used to using the receipts, or you can say, you know, the daily transactional activities that they do. So they're akin to that kind of a you know, language. But if you introduce any other language like oops or, you know, this and that, so it will all go down the drain. So how do you solve, you know, those problems? How do you think about that? So what we did was, for example, in the error part was that we were very direct in our approach and we were very actionable. Let's say that your internet is down. Please, tap this icon and or check your connection. So something like that. So we were very prompt in the message that we were giving. Mm-hmm. And we were only ensuring that they are actionable and nothing is like, you know, just sort of pleasantries. Correct.
So what does the error message look like?
So we had a traffic signal. So it had a red, so with a red light on, and a very actionable crisp message that your internet is not working, something like that. That's it. So, and that too in Hindi. Mm-hmm. Aapka internet kaam nahi kar raha. Mm-hmm. Something like that. So mm-hmm. It was very, you know, Hindi that we use in our day-to-day lives. Nothing flashy.
Correct. And you also mentioned about them getting agitated because certain things are not working. So is there any other insight to be shared on that while designing?
So basically what we made sure was that there were two sets of users for us. So one was a set of user which was used to using the smartphones. Mm-hmm. And one was a completely new, you know, who is using our app as their first app in the life. So something like that. So what we made sure that while we were, before even we were developing that product, we made prototypes and we were testing those prototypes with both kind of audience. So we were testing it with someone who will have a lesser learning curve, and you were testing it with someone who will have a very steep learning curve. So we ensured that, you know, a user like someone who is not used the app ever before is very comfortable and goes through the app very naturally, and we never intended to create any ambiguous interactions in the app as well. So it was like an ATM machine. So we thought of the, you know, something to create something like an ATM machine where, it gives you the voice feedback as well that, you know, so we actually integrated our app with Google's API, you know, a text-to-speech API. So there was a readout like, aapko yahan pe jana hai, sham ke 7:30 baje tak. So this was all possible because of, you know, all those deep technologies that we're using, but essentially everything was coming out as very simple and very, toned down.
Wow. So, yeah. Wow. And what were the learnings while you were on your road trip?
So, yeah. So essentially what I wanted to do was to understand, how these players are actually playing within themselves. What role is WhatsApp or what role is, text messages, etc. What are the tools that they are using? So this was a completely new experience for me. While meeting, it was like, you know, I went with a questionnaire, but I had to dumb down the questionnaire somewhere, you know, down my in between. So the idea really which helped me was that I wanted to follow all those process, traditional process that, you know, we as designers follow while we are back in our offices. But at the same time, how to collect that data? So there were two problems, you know, overall that, you know, what methodology to follow while you're designing for this set of user, and how will you recruit these users, because they are always on the move. So you can easily recruit someone, some user of a, you know, Amazon or Flipkart app, but how do you kind of, you know, approach this kind of a user? So what we did was we kind of stick to the, you know, the basics of the design part, and we came out with the questions that we wanted to ask. Now the way that what we did was we went a, you know, step ahead, and what we did was we created a set of conversation out of those questions, that if we I want to ask this question, what is the conversation that I need to strike? Something like that. So we did this extra step of creating a script or a conversation around it. And then user recruitment was like, striking conversation with them. So we just went ahead over chai and over, sometimes even hookah. So so it was like...
On the roadside, dabas.
So, having a conversation, and I was recording all this. Then I went back and kind of, took notes out of it while back. So you really have to innovate, how you want to gather the data. But at the same time, I didn't want it to reinvent anything, out of the box. So, yeah.
Correct. Coming to that reinvent part, so how are you trying to solve these challenges? I mean, since you have some sort of insights into how things are working in that space, what are your steps you have been taking so far within the organization, within Blackbuck, to try and solve these challenges?
Okay, so basically, see, the there are two aspects to this. First is, your organization itself needs to step a forward foot and say that, okay, let design and let the customer experience be the key where you differentiate from all other products or all other services that are out there in the market. And I was lucky enough to be working in an organization which felt that, yes, user experience is the key to kind of crack this space. So that ways it was a challenge which was not really a challenge for me. Now, the second challenge to kind of, actually implement the learnings in a very fast-paced environment is, again, something which, and where, all the wheels are moving at the same time. So there are, there are truckers, then there are shippers, then there are truck drivers, and everything has to be well coordinated. So essentially, the second part of the learning was how to, bring all those business challenges or business, problems that are there and kind of translate that to the product so that, I am really, and so that the product is really simple to the end users who are using it, and we have not created something very complex or, so we wanted to go in that direction, essentially.
Interesting. So you briefly touched upon saying that dumbing down the questions, dumbing down the interface communication which is happening. Any other insights in terms of, because like we spoke, they are not even aware of Google Maps, right? So how to navigate, what is in, like how the traffic looks like, and any other insights on that, like which has helped you from your learnings translate into the design language which you are using?
So yeah, so basically what we are doing in the system is that, we are ensuring that the drivers, so basically we are focusing a lot on the drivers. So we are ensuring that the truck that he's using is all, is, so we have actually put a lot of sensors on the truck. So we are measuring a lot of data, which otherwise, because the truck driver is actually the pseudo owner of the truck. He stays on the truck for 24 days in a month, so, and he sleeps in the truck. So this data is there, but in a very traditional scenario, a fleet owner doesn't know, where his truck driver is. A broker might be misusing the truck driver for, for a fuel theft or something like that. So all those, activities are well there, in this area. But what we are trying to do is we are trying to infuse all these, infuse the traditional trucks with more technology and more sensors, which can kind of, give us back the data that, about how, where are the drivers stopping, where are the drivers, so basically we have started using digital fuel cards where, you actually don't need a fuel card at all. The truck can actually go there and there will be an OTP on his mobile number, and the fuel and the fueling would be done instantly. So that is how seamless we have made the entire process with no interaction at all. Another thing is about the toll. So, when a truck actually passes through a toll, if they are using the FastTag toll card, which, we are giving to them, so they can actually pass without, paying anything cash or anything like that. They can just pass through it and money will be automatically deducted by from their chips, basically. So this is how what we are kind, trying to do, bringing the modern technology into a sector which is kind of, not very looked upon.
Wow, interesting. So Viraj, I would like to slightly deep dive in one of the questions. Is one of your critical users, as you mentioned, is a truck driver.
Right.
So as we know, they are either like completely drunk from whatever experience I have at least,
mm-hmm.
or frustrated in a road rage, because I've done like a lot of trips from Bombay, Bangalore at least on the road.
Right.
So I've seen them right from like last 10 years.
Mm-hmm.
So how are you handling errors or exceptions for them? I mean, this is slightly a nuanced question, but yeah, this might share some insights on mm-hmm. the process itself.
Right. So actually, that is a misconception, Kedar. Mm. So, you know, even these drivers, you know, they are trying to just do their duties, do their, you know, trucking for like 24 days in a month and go back to their homes, happy with their family without any accident. So even they don't want to cause any trouble. The thing is that, you know, these people themselves have been tormented by the traffic police or even their owners. So that is the, and you know, they are like, for the duty that they are doing, they are paid close to nothing. So that is what the condition really is. So we have given them a flexibility to choose their leaves across the month in our app, basically. So what we are saying is that you can schedule whenever you want to work, whenever you want to go home. So we are giving them that flexibility with us. And we are also making the truck more high-tech. So we are infusing, you know, so one of the solutions that came out of our hackathon was a black box for a truck that, you know, when there's a crash, when there's a damage on the truck, the mobile app would actually start recording the video and, you know, alert the authorities, alert the hospitals nearby. Typically, which, you know, takes hours and hours after the accident is actually kind of, you know, we have the data now with us. So those are the things that, you know, slowly and slowly we are touching upon, understanding the problems and hitting those with solutions. Yep.
Wow, that's really interesting. It's getting more
right.
Yeah, I'm getting more curious about and actually wanting to like see the app itself.
Yeah. I'll definitely show you, Kedar.
Sure. So what has been your like biggest learning as a designer in this while designing this Blackbuck app?
Okay. So yeah, so basically we as designers, you know, we must take the problem with all its unique aspects, with all its constraints which are there, and think about new and fresh solutions instead of aiming for a slightly better Me Too product. We should not, you know, just simply look for inspirations for in a US-based product or a Chinese-based product whenever we are starting a project. We should actually, you know, trust the design process and accept the problem with all its constraints and, you know, blend them together to create something actually new. So in this way, you know, we can actually, and this makes the entire process very enjoyable, and you can actually see the results which you initially intended for. So I think that has been really the biggest learning for me, that, you know, when given a problem, we should always, you know, inspect it with fresh eyes and try to solve it with using all the design tools, and it will really end up in something, you know, unique. So, yes.
Correct. Yeah, I mean, because typically when a person starts, it starts with referencing first. So, I think we'll cover that question coming.
Right.
Yeah. So, you also spoke about your travel across India to understand. But if we want to slightly dig deeper into understanding, like, how do you do your user research? Because now you have a set of learnings.
Mm-hmm.
And if you can also tell me how many people have you on your team who do specifically user research, because there's continuous learning. This industry is 50 years old. So there's a lot more to comprehend, a lot more to generate data out of. Because so how does that user research part work?
Okay. So basically, as I said, you know, when I was, so I was the first one over there in the design team at Blackbuck. So the first step of research that I did was traveling across geographies, understanding what are the, you know, minute differences while I'm talking to Punjab's fleet owner versus a Gujarat's fleet owner. So I was actually, you know, digging deep, trying to understand what their lives are really alike around the industry that they are in. So that was the first set of, you know, research parameters that we were collecting about while we were making personas, while we were identifying the problems. So after doing that, what we did was we compiled all those things into our prototype, and we went out there testing back again, giving them the you know, the app even before launching it. So that really, you know, eliminated a lot of our assumptions. For example, you know, so there are a lot of assumptions that you can make while sitting in a you know, AC office at Bangalore, that these truck drivers, they don't have, let's say, bank accounts. But what we found out was completely different. These people do have bank accounts. It's just that, you know, they are not using it. But we actually made sure that we are actually transferring all the amounts that we need to transfer to their bank accounts. So this is like one of the learning which you only get after you go onto the ground, understand, talk to your users, understand them really well. Some of the other you know, challenges were like, will he be able to kind of, you know, make out a button, for example? What is the concept of button for someone like him? So what we did was ki we made a very different design system, wherein, you know, we took a lot of aspects of the products that they were already using, which were only WhatsApp and Facebook, you know, as far as my research. So we took a lot of those elements and we tried to make our own design system for, you know, such audience. And in the process, we actually eliminated all the textual buttons. We eliminated anything that is very cluttered, you know, to them. So it actually really came out really well. So this is all based on the research that we did, you know, before launching the app, which actually solved a lot of problems for us. Now, after launching, again, you know, how do you make him to update the app, and how do you kind of, you know, develop a product which is already out there with all these constraints that, you know, even if you maybe move a button from here to there, so there might be a lot of commotion that samajh mein nahi aa raha hai, ye nahi ho raha hai. So we actually, you were very careful even while we were incrementally improving the app. So we were not touching the aspects which are working well for us. We were only, you know, kind of adding on features which we really thought. And one of the best part about incremental process is that, you know, you can build something, you know, which is high priority for such kind of audience to actually low priorities, and et cetera. You don't have to, you know, clutter the product really that much. So that was that incremental step journey really helped. And so there was kind of, you know, all of this coming together. I can say that when I did my research back again, so I went for a trip again 2 months back, and when I was there interviewing with someone who has really earned 17,000 rupees to 20,000 rupees in a month's time with us, whom we have, you know, tripled the income for. So meeting all those people, it was really kind of, you know, a validation that yes, what we have created actually works, and people are actually, you know, multiplying their incomes out of it. So it was all coming into, you know, pieces.
Correct. Yeah. Like, I don't know whether you have seen Aankho Dekhi.
No, I have not seen Aankho Dekhi.
So in that, the movie premises that there's a guy who decides that he will not believe until he sees. So right. So and that's how he builds his philosophy in life. And his daughter is going to get married, so he designs a invitation card. So typically, an invitation card has Ganpati or whatever, some sort of a thing. And since he doesn't believe in any of those things, he really makes a super minimal Zen looking invitation card.
Right.
And nice. That's how that somehow connects me to this portion, because when you are against all but the biases and purely implementing your learnings, it becomes truly minimal, because you're keeping the things which actually matter and then removing all the fluff. So yeah, I mean, I'm sure the product looks minimal in itself.
Right, that's a good analogy to make, actually. Yes.
So Viraj, since there isn't anyone doing much for these tier 2 or tier 3 cities, or users, if I may say, what is your source of inspiration? I mean, like, how do you refer? I'm sure you must not be referring to a lot of things, but for people like us, at least, who have worked in Ola, ClearTrip, and Book My Show and other places, they have like a natural incline towards go to Dribbble, check out certain interaction patterns, read Medium posts, and then come up with some sort of a interaction or a design thing. So what is your source of inspiration in here?
So at first the thought was really scary, that how am I going to design, you know, for an audience, you know, which has never used any app other than Facebook or WhatsApp. How should I make a very superior you know, design system like Airbnb for such kind of an audience, or was there even a need for creating that kind of a design system? Does that mean that I have to create very dumbed down designs, or do I have to make crappy UI? So it all led to a very existential crisis for me, that whether my UX career is on the downward spiral. That was the mindset for me when I started this project. Mm. But really, the answer really is that not having direct inspirations is sometimes good. Like, you can create something very unique. So when you really follow the design process, somewhere it says that, you have to make something where the learning curves are not steep. And you have to make something very familiar. So taking those advices, we realized that the percentage of audience using smartphones used Facebook and WhatsApp for 99% of their time. So this was really the key to kind of, build a system, a design system out of. So what we did was we picked up some elements from Facebook and WhatsApp, which they are using and which they are used to seeing on a daily basis. And we created our own design system. So basically, this actually helped both kinds of users, the users who are using the smartphones and the users who were not familiar with smartphones at all. We actually asked questions like, there's only one button on the screen, and we actually asked that, agar aapko aage jana hai to kahan dabayenge? So we actually went to that detail from ensuring that, the system actually works, or the interaction actually works. So we did all those things. So before this stint, I never believed in the idea of a tier 2, tier 3, setup in India using digital products for something useful. But my view has completely changed, that it is not their fault, but actually our fault when we are making products. A great product by definition adds value to the lives of everyone who is using it. Mm. But if a person is not able to use it, then it's a designer's fault that he is not getting the value that was actually for him. So I think we actually need to look from those angles while we are solving some problems that are very unconventional or very India specific.
Mm-hmm. Yes. Beautiful. In fact, one of the reasons why I wanted to have this Audiogyan is also because since I've started Audiogyan, I have been interviewing a lot of different types of designers. But when I mm-hmm. interview people, at least professors from IDC and others, I interviewed Uday Atvankar, Gaur Gopal Ray, and other people, and all of them are trying to solve a problem for the mm-hmm. really... The people who really need it.
Correct.
When we talk about ergonomics, I was in this utopian world of saying ergonomics to chair hoti hai, yeah, utensils hote hai, like how do you design for that and things like that. So I had very superficial questions, but their answers gave me a lot of insights. Like he gave me an example where there's a brick worker who squats and makes 600 or 700 bricks a day.
Oh.
And which is not an ergonomic position to sit and work on. Oh. So how do you design a system for that where a person will stand and can be much more effective, much more productive, and also have a longer life of his own as well.
Right.
So yeah, I mean, that's really inspiring. Actually, just given the time, there are last two questions which I have. Sure. Since you're actually solving a problem, like a real world problem, which is sort of slightly uncool, as you also mentioned, ki existential tension aa gaya. So what keeps you going? Because it's not very glamorous, if I can say, if I can use that word, right? I mean, a person who's designing for a tier 3, like Ludhiana mein truck driver ke liye design kar raha hai, and one who's designing like a ultra modern whatever Myntra ka app,
yes.
So how do you like, what keeps you going and how do you keep yourself motivated? This is slightly personal, but yeah.
So I have actually worked on home decor and virtual credit card apps in the past,
mm-hmm.
Which was for a very polished audience. Mm. But this was a unique experience. To transform a traditional sector and infuse it with new digital tools and create a billion-dollar startup, like it was like an experience, a journey, a ride for me. Mm. So there are so many situations in India where there is an opportunity to solve. very real problems. You know, you just go to a road trip towards the, you know, tier 2 cities and tier 2 towns, and you will find a bunch of problems that we take for very granted while living in the metros and cities, right? Mm. So, if only one can break from the status quo and, you know, we can dive in with determination that we want to create quality products, you know, quality products which actually
impact lives.
Impacts, you know, their lives. So, it is possible. This has actually made me bolder as a designer to voice my opinions and, you know, express them freely. So I think that has been the journey so far, which has motivated me to, you know, pursue something which nobody else is pursuing. Yes.
Wow. Awesome. So one of my hopes is that this podcast makes like the listeners, the designers, aware of the kind of real challenges you're dealing with. So any insights, because this, I hope that there are a lot of people out there who are looking for jobs also, and also they get sensitive to this kind of problems in India. So what are your expectations from a designer community and talent if you are trying to acquire more, as you mentioned? Right. So what is that you are looking for? Because I wouldn't mention about our requirements, but yeah.
So you know, at this point I would encourage more young designers and entrepreneurs to pick up problems they are thinking that are very India specific. Mm. You know, a solution which is too good to be true to exist for this kind of a problem. So I want them to actually pursue those problems, because India is a growing economy and in need of dire creative minds who can break the status quo and solve problems, you know, more innovatively. Mm-hmm. So we really need that kind of a passion towards, you know, all those problems. And who knows that, you know, the solution that you are building becomes the next $1 billion startup. So it is, you know, that kind of an opportunity which is lying over there, but people are just not pursuing it. It can be multiple reasons, because of the status quo, because of, you know, not observing it enough, not even being aware that that is a problem. So we really need to come forward out of our comfort zones and, you know, solve a lot many real world problems.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, actually people need to travel across India. One of my friends who's traveled extensively speaks almost a similar language.
Travel gives you a lot of insights and a lot of perspectives.
Yeah, sure. All right, I think that's a good note to end this. You want to add any concluding thoughts about Blackbuck, or maybe this could be a platform for you to reach out to some designers and ask for
sure
applying?
So Blackbuck has been an amazing journey. We never thought that we would come this far and create so much impact with the digital tools that we have created in the past 3 years, and it is growing on a very accelerated pace. We have like 1,000 member team which is spread across India, so we are hiring. So designers who are actually looking out for a change in Bangalore can actually get in touch with me, Kedar. My email ID is vermaviraj91@gmail.com.
Okay.
We can give that in the link as well.
Sure.
So that is what our mission is. We are actually transforming this entire freight sector, bringing organization into this highly organized informal sector, and increasing the incomes of an entity like truck driver, who nobody thinks about. So if you are really passionate about solving some real world problems, and you want to join a startup that can give growth to your career, you should probably consider a startup like Blackbuck.
Sure, definitely. I hope a lot of people get inspired by listening to this, and all the best for your ongoing challenges at Blackbuck.
Thank you, Kedar.
And it was really nice talking to you.
Same here, Kedar.
Thanks.
All the best for to Audiogyan.
Thank you.
And that's it from today's Gyan session. Catch us on iTunes, Savan, Stitcher, or any podcasting app you use. Do rate us on iTunes and follow us on Twitter, Facebook, and Instagram. Stay tuned for more Gyan on audiogyan.com. Till then, bye.